Before introducing the guest of honor and the guest of honor's XYL, as they say in ham radio parlance, I'd like to explain why I felt that it'd be good to invite John Mauchly here. Some years ago, Isaac Asimov, whom I'm sure most of you people recognize, science fiction writer. Some years ago, Isaac Asimov, the science fiction author, identified three breakthroughs in the history of communications at a dinner I attended, something like this. The first one, he said, was about 40,000 BC, and that was when man first was able to communicate with sounds that were meaningful to another human being. The next communication breakthrough he cited as being about 4,000 BC, when man was able to put his thoughts on stones or rocks, chipping them, and that enabled now the message to be passed on, physically intact, maybe misunderstood, but at least physically intact, from one part of the country to another. It was heavy stuff, you know, but I couldn't resist that. The next communication breakthrough, and the third one that Asimov identified, was 1500 AD, essentially 1490, essentially the invention of printing with movable type. Because with that means, not only were we able to write the message and transmit it and have it delivered intact, although misunderstood, we were now able to write the message, transmit it, and have it delivered intact in millions of copies, all of which totally misunderstood. And this is the age that really we are at the tail end of. If you plot those dates on log paper, approximately, you will discover that 1945 is a reasonable next communication breakthrough. And that is the date when, effectively, the electronic digital computer was born, as opposed to preceding calculating machines of the sort epitomized by Mark I at MIT and some of the other calculators. It was in 1945-46 that John Mauchly, with his colleague Eckert at the University of Pennsylvania, built ENIAC, and it was formally opened and displayed. ENIAC had about 18,000 electron tubes in it, fans and blowers, but no air conditioning. Repair was a constant problem, it says here, and it could do 5,000 additions a second. I thought that in order to understand really what we're talking about and what happened 21 years ago this year, just 21 years ago, on every table there's a stack of papers, which I hope you've passed around, which shows a photograph of ENIAC, and it shows John Mauchly leaning against a column, looking not too concerned. That whole installation, I would say, could be characterized as being the equivalent of one of Art Fowler's $3 calculators that you find on a box on the floor in his store. Effectively, that was what it was capable of doing, approximately. So this is where we've gone in 21 years. Interestingly, nobody remembers the name of the first man who discovered that he could talk to another human being with grunts. Nobody remembers the name of the first man who chipped something on the rock. People do remember Gutenberg. And more so, people remember John Mauchly. He's one of the very few people alive today who has equipment that he designed and built in the Smithsonian. Usually that's an honor reserved for those several hundred years dead. He's one of the very few people, in fact, he's the only person with his ex-colleague, Presper Eckert, who received the Potts Medal from the Franklin Institute. And I asked John earlier, because it seems to me that the citation read something that this invention qualified him for the medal because it was ingenious in nature. I think the word ingenious was in the citation back in 10 to 15 years after the computer. And what John pointed out to me was that it is most unusual for that medal to be awarded to anybody so soon after the work was accomplished. So, if you take now my original numbers and the log paper, and figure the 1945 is the fourth communication breakthrough,
Namely, that's the one that now enables us to communicate, but have the errors corrected by the machine in the communication process. Or to do the translation, semantic. And we've heard this, and you know, this is no longer a great big deal. Plot when the next breakthrough will be. And it'll be within his lifetime, in all probability, 1984. And the next breakthrough, 1985. And the next one, 1985 and 1 week. And the next one, 1985, 1 week and 1 minute, approximately. I think we're getting there. Well, the fact I'd like to read now, just before introducing John, from a history book of the of history and science in the Bell system, a statement that the most significant achievement during this period, and they're talking of the 1940-45 period, of course, comma, was the development of the ENIAC computer at the Moore School of Electrical Engineering for the U.S. Army's Ordnance Department under the direction of John W. Mauchly and J. Presper Eckert. I'm now pausing. I will now give this paper to John and let him read to himself the rest of the sentence, and I think he will have some words to say on the matter. So, John. Incidentally, I would like to say, I'm sorry, I should have mentioned that with him, equally important in this business, is Kathleen Mauchly. She was not married to him at the time when she bit-switched that first computer, programming it, thereby being the first woman programmer of an electronic digital computer. I won't say of all computers, Lady Lovelace has that distinction with Charles Babbage. But for electronic computers, unquestionably, Kathleen Mauchly is the first one to have been a woman programmer.
Yeah, I think so. I'm going to get untangled from these wires. Well, Claude deliberately, of course, led me down that primrose path. Some people bait you one way, some people bait you another. With plenty of errors which need to be either propagated or demolished or usually mixed up into a new home brew. Oh, that's a forbidden word now. That's reserved for small computers. Well, we homebrewed ours a little different way, and this next sentence, which was not read to you a minute ago, said that the these two gentlemen, Eckert and Mauchly, were using the inspiration of Dr. John von Neumann. Well, you must say that the Gutenberg invention long ago did enable man to propagate his errors faster. And so there have been many things published, even in the most prestigious encyclopedias, which are propagating errors faster. We don't know whether we're going to be able to keep up with that or not. There's some things go faster than the speed of sound. Even that oil that was getting out of the oil field over in the North Sea, they said was moving faster than the speed of sound, until they finally succeeded in capping it. Here, we're just keeping up with the speed of sound, as you note from the noises. But at any rate, I brought with me a few ancient relics. I don't know whether the Kagan barn has any of these, but I thought I would display them in a moment, because there's so many things connected with the early history, or the circumstances surrounding, as the title here says, that ought to be touched upon, and we'll only be able to touch on a few. Fortunately, we are all been provided with that picture of the ENIAC. And So I can play this game either way. I can say, well, I know, I've heard it. The Chinese or somebody said, one picture is worth 10,000 words. And each one of you has this picture. So of course, I should be entitled to give you now 10,000 words for each one of those pictures, and that'll take quite a while. Or I might apply the ratio the other way around. I can be as flexible as all these prize-winning economists are nowadays. They seem to be arguing either way on inflation, either way on gas tax, either way on anything. You can find arguments from statisticians, from economists, and so on, to suit whatever mode, whatever thing you want to prove. But I was there, Charlie, at the beginning of a certain computer known as ENIAC, and so I hope you'll believe me that some of the things I say, as well as coming from the mouth, they come from the heart, and they come a little bit from the brain cells, the memory store. To go way back, of course, there was Babbage, there was Lady Lovelace, and strangely enough, that was a history I didn't know about. I was just a poor college professor trying to solve weather problems and decided it was just too much for me and I wouldn't live long enough. So some of my friends knew about electronics, were using it in physics labs and cosmic rays, and I took over that, saying, that's the way to get some speed and maybe get this problem solved in my lifetime. But there was another essential ingredient, as all of us, most of us well know. It's called mazula or mula or money. And if you don't have that, why, you can't get anywhere until, what is it, until 1977 when computers become a dime a dozen. At that time, they were not a dime a dozen. And so, it's to the great credit of some people at the Moore School of Engineering and the Army Ordnance people that when I moved to that scene, instead of a liberal arts college or sinus, I moved to the Moore School, that I found people who, although they would not believe that an electronic computer was practical and would work, they were willing to gamble a little. So it was with the taxpayers' money during World War II that some of that gamble, some of the bets were placed on the idea that let's try it anyway. What have we got to lose? Only a war. So it's better maybe to lose $500,000, which what our gamble cost, than it was to lose the war. Maybe we can do something valuable for war work by finding out how to make the guns that are already made and delivered able to shoot the target. Now my wife, who got lost here somewhere, will tell you something about that probably, because she was involved in that business of trying to make trajectories by some things they call were new-fashioned methods. That is by analog machines, gears, and things grinding, and finally producing firing tables for the guns. We said, this is a way to produce them faster. And so in 1941, I talked about this. Nobody thought it was really worth doing anything about. 1942, some of my good advisors, the Moore School, said, write it down. In 1943, I found a favorable listener in a new ordnance department man, Dr. Goldstein, who came there to see if he couldn't expedite this new-fashioned, old-fashioned work done with gears and wheels and all that. And he said, you should write it down. I said, I've already done it. Well, as history records, this is one place where history is right. History records, actually, that that memo that I had written and circulated had somehow got lost and had to be regenerated And it was successfully recovered from Greg's shorthand notes by a very competent secretary. With that memo and some more information, why, on Eckert's birthday, April 9th, 1943, tentative approval of the so-called ENIAC project was obtained. That meant we would start work, even though there wasn't an absolutely formal contract with the university. So we started work then. My wife asked me the other day, well, where did you get all the people and built this thing? I said, I wish I knew. I was the outsider, you might say, who came to the Moore School from a liberal arts college. Practically all the people that worked on that machine were either electrical engineers or close to it, and were known to the electrical engineering people, the staff at the Moore School. Some of them were there taking graduate work, and others were friends of theirs and so on, and we assembled the staff of, just thousands of people. You know what a cast of thousands it takes to build a computer nowadays. It didn't take that. It only took, I think, a staff of 12, not all of whom were actually full engineering degree men. But we all got together in a small room, you know, and talked over what we wanted to do and sketched out the plans. And pretty soon we were underway. The very first thing to do was to build something called electronic counters. What you might see as a little chip nowadays, you know, is a little circuit counts, maybe this big, maybe just a very small fraction of a full chip. Those days was a chassis with dozens of tubes in it, lots of busbar wires going from end to end to convey the various voltages required by vacuum tubes. You've heard of vacuum tubes, haven't you? Yeah, I have to explain that sometimes to high school students, and probably some of you are high school students, and so you may not know what a vacuum tube is, or you've just vaguely heard of it. And there was a man who named DeForest who lived long enough to hear about the transistor, and a few years ago wrote a very vehement letter to the Scientific American protesting because a physicist had written in the Scientific American there was nothing wrong with electronic computers that wouldn't be cured by the elimination of the vacuum tube. Well, he didn't realize how right that article was. But as far as he was concerned, why a vacuum tube was used in WLW, you know, a big broadcasting station with a million watts or so. When would a transistor ever be able to handle more than a microwatt? And so on. So transistors shouldn't even be considered. Gee, if he could see it now. Well, the industry has made those great strides, and it has brought about a vision, or rather a realization of what I had hoped would happen someday but never realized would come this soon or this adequately. When I and Eckert and the other 10 or 12 engineers finished in 2.5 years and in 1946, came out with this machine, financed by Army Ordnance, demonstrated it, I had to speak at a press conference. And, of course, the people that came from the news media, the magazines, the newspapers, and everything else, what in the world were we talking about, you know, electronic computers? It was very hard for them to imagine, but we had the working machine there to demonstrate to them. And we could slow it down and speed it up by the manually controlled oscillator knob if we wished, and show them how it worked, and take it step by step, or speed it up and show them how fast it would go, and all those things. But, well, what use is it anyway? Who wants to compute that fast? Besides, of course, the War Department of the Ordnance, who apparently had some esoteric need which news reporters didn't really understand. They just took on faith that if they need it, they wanted to spend the taxpayers' money, okay. But I said at that dedication that there'd be all sorts of uses for computers in the future. And I tried to imagine as many as I could. And Presper Eckert tried to imagine as many as he could. And Goldstein and others tried to fill in the possible uses. And solving differential equations. I, for instance, said there are lots of uses in weather because that's what led me to computers. The fact that I had so many computations that I thought needed to be done before weather forecasting would be improved. Other people would like to have other things. And I said that we might even make wind tunnels obsolete someday, you know, they could mathematically compute the properties of airfoils and how planes would fly and so forth. Just the other day, I saw one of these ads from some big company. It used to be called Itty Bitty Machine Company, but there's another company that's really called that now, as you know. It's no longer a joke. So this big Itty Bitty Machine Company has an ad, for instance, on which it shows airplane designers with all sorts of cathode ray screens and light pens and all that business altering the fuselage shape so that the wheels can come down. That, of course, is minor back-age stuff because you don't see the ads yet designing the spaceships that way, especially not the completely circular saucer-shaped ones, which some of us have seen and know well. Yeah. So, I have a few things I really want to tell you before I let my wife have a chance. And she's going to say, sit down right quick. But one of the things I'm supposed to tell you is I told you about the 12 engineers, but I didn't really tell you how I met Eckert. And since he isn't here, why, of course, I can say anything I like behind his back. But I also feel a sort of compassion, you might say, a duty to tell you some truth about it. Sometimes it is said, and history, you know, turns these things around, since he is 12 years younger than I, and I am 12 years older than he is, this mathematics is different from what Claude learned. He's got the new math, so he said it was 31 years ago, or 21 years ago, or something. You subtract 46 from 77 and see what you get. Back in those days, some people say that Eckert was a student of mine. Now, I was his teacher because I was on the staff of the Moore School. Not so. I was a student of Eckert's, but not a student of Neumann's. What I learned from Eckert, however, was electronics, because he was the teacher of electronics at the Moore School summer session where I elected to get U.S. tax money to pay to learn, for me to learn electronics so I might possibly be more useful in the war effort than all those physicists who were a dime a dozen. So, having successfully lived through a three-month lab course, which was identical to the one I gave the graduating seniors, the upperclassmen at Ursinus College, if they wanted to take an advanced physics course, having successfully gotten through that by talking to Eckert rather than doing the experiments, which were the ones that I taught my students at Ursinus, by then, Eckert and I were on the same plane and we could discuss the feasibility of making a computer work electronically. What means this, feasibility? It wasn't a problem at all as far as I was concerned or as far as Eckert was concerned to design circuits which would count. The cosmic ray scientists were doing that. what was important was not that they count and not that they count fast. That was for sure. The important thing was that they be reliable. And the reliability is important not only for computing firing tables for guns, but for everything, including its use in commerce, payroll, whatever you like. You don't like errors in your payroll if you have one, or your paycheck if you have one. Some of us are not that fortunate. Well, at any rate, so I give great credit to Eckert for being a great reliability man before they ever coined the word reliability engineer. And it was his job, you might say, to see to the reliability of these circuits. It was my job to see that these reliable circuits were flexible enough to handle all the possible kinds of calculations that we thought anybody would ever want to do. Fortunately, the Army Ordnance people went along with this. They said, the war will be over someday, and we want this computer for which we paid some money, like $500,000, that sounded big those days. Nowadays, $500 million is nothing. But $500,000 then was a big investment, and they wanted to be able to say, that computer will be worth something after the war. And we wanted to be able to handle anything. And that's what we did. And along came, toward the end of this period, a man who was well known as a scientist for atomic energy and all kinds of other things, von Neumann. He came from Princeton to find out what we were doing because he was very much interested in calculation. He wanted to see calculation done faster, but he'd never had an idea how to do it faster. So when he heard what we were doing, bing, bing, he caught on fast. And the next thing you know, why, Goldstein was up at Princeton and von Neumann was there, and they were trying to get their money for their computer. And what was Presper Eckert and Mauchly to do? Well, we were trying to promote a project to carry on a better computer at Moore School. But with the exigencies of war gone, that's a nice word, isn't it? With the exigencies of war exited from the door, why, we found nobody at the Moore School had the slightest idea how to get funds to proceed. So I tried to help. I went down to the Census Bureau, and to make a long story short there, why, when things worked out so that nobody really knew how to handle the situation at the Moore School to fund things at that point, why, Eckert and I went into business and made a first computer for the first UNIVAC for the Census Bureau. And they celebrated the 25th anniversary of that delivery of a UNIVAC in 1976. It was delivered in 51. Just ahead of that, we had gotten a contract from Northrop Aircraft to try to build a flying computer which would guide missiles. It was a very big secret then. We couldn't talk about it. But we took the contract. And the reason I mention it now is because it sort of slipped into oblivion in a big computer history which was put out by the ACM and the AFIPS and so on a few years, last year or something. In that history, there's a picture of BINAC, but nothing in the index tells you there is such a picture. So they didn't index the book, I guess, by text processing and computers. But at any rate, that history, that Encyclopedia of Computer Science missed out on several things. One of the important things to some people is that, as far as I know, that was the first computer that played music. It really played music. Not as good as what I heard today, of course. We merely discovered by accident, because the technicians working on our BINAC computer wanted to be amused while they were working and had a transistor, an old